between my eyes. Walked through the fire, came out better on the other side. See, life's like a beach if you find the sand. And right now, I'm feeling like $100,000.
You are listening to Inspired Insider with your host, Dr. Jeremy Weisz.
Dr. Jeremy Weisz here, founder of InspiredInsider.com, where I talk with inspirational entrepreneurs like the founders of P90 X, Atari, the legendary infomercial king Ron Popeil, many more, how they overcome big challenges in life and business. Our sponsor today is Rise25.com, where entrepreneurs of 6, 7, 8-figure businesses come together live and in person every few months, solve their biggest business challenges, and leave with lifelong friendships. Check out Rise25.com. It's run by myself and co-founder John Corcoran. It's application only. Today, I'm very excited. There's some people, when they do interviews, they want to interview Oprah or Elon Musk. For me, on my list, no joke, Ed, was Ed O'Keefe. And you will see why in a minute. Today, we have Ed O'Keefe. He's father of 7, grew up in a household of 13 children. He's author of the book Time Collapsing, The New Art of Speed, Money, Power, and Meaning. He's used his time collapsing methods to leap to the top of industries, and he's started multiple companies from scratch to multiple 7 and 8, even 8-figure businesses. In dentistry, he sold over $50 million in marketing systems and seminars. He started Marine Essentials and has sold over $60 million in health supplements. And this is all with 7 kids. One of the most impressive things about Ed's resume is a Kokoro 40 graduate. 51-hour mini hell week created by Commander Mark Divine. Crazy stuff, which we'll talk about. And he has a podcast, the EdO'KeefeShow.com. Check it out. He's also an investor in NoFoods.com, which is a health food company that is disrupting the food industry. Ed, thank you for joining me.
What's up, man? How are you? Yeah, thanks for
having me. Oh, my God. I have like notes in front of me, 15 pages of notes in front of me. Kokoro, kids, time collapsing, Marine D3, dentist profits, patterns, modeling, losing the friction, freedom question. So we're going to go through a lot of stuff, but
let's do it.
I want to know, top of mind, you know, I asked in the beginning what's top of mind for you, and you said no foods.
Yeah, no foods.
And Jesse Itzler, talk about no foods for a second. What are you working on with no foods?
Well, I'm actually like literally, here's my waffle. I got a chocolate chip muffin or chocolate chip waffle for lunch because it's got so much protein in it. It's got good fats in it. It's made of egg whites, chia seeds, flaxseed oil,
And when you buy it, it comes like that, right? It comes
like this. So like literally I got into the office. I'd already eaten some after and I had a client call. So I was on a client call. I get in the office. I'm sitting there. I'm like, my gosh, the time's flying by. It's 1:30. I got to get my lunch. And I just grabbed thank God I had in our freezers, 2 waffles. And I threw them in. It's 26 grams of protein. Getting all my good fats in, and man, I'll tell you, as Jesse would say, he's eating them like Tic Tacs, like talking about the chocolate chip muffins. Now, here's what I want to say, everybody. So on this, the reason I'm so excited is because the research that we're doing and work, the people that are, it's all going to come out in the next 60 to 90 days. The doctors that are getting behind this, the data that's coming out on insulin levels and glucose, there's like no spike in glucose levels, which is obviously one of the biggest challenges with obesity, diabetes.
So they're doing testing with those conditions like diabetes.
People are doing it. Yeah, it's a little. Some of the doctors are doing some blood sugar stuff.
And got
it's not in the open yet, so I can't share too much about that. But it's like the blood sugar is not raising at all eating some of these. So no foods is just everyone's going to hear more about it. It's gluten free, grain free, peanut free, dairy free. I could pitch it all day long.
Not taste free though.
Tastes phenomenal. Yeah. Tastes phenomenal. Yeah. I went into my CrossFit box yesterday. They were like, "Hey, what's in your bag?" And I had 4 of the chocolate chip waffles, and I think one was left over for me after all of them devoured it. And
how did you get involved with No Foods?
Yeah. So No Foods. I was at Jesse's house. Yeah, him and his wife Sarah Blakely, who's the founder of Spanx, and my wife and I were there for their charity event they run at their house called Hell on the Hill, which is freaking amazing, by the way. It's literally I cried after Kokoro. I have video of me crying after Hell on the Hill, because I'll tell you, Jeremy, there's something sick and nasty about running up a hill. No, you can't run up the hill.
Yeah, describe what Hell on the Hill is.
Because
you trained pretty hard for Hell on the Hill, didn't you?
I trained hard for it, and I did not train properly for it. Because the hill, it's something that Jesse was doing. So he was training for like a 100-mile adventure race. And we're talking about Jesse Itzler. Jesse was the founder of Marquee Jets, which was the first, I think it was the first like private, like you can buy your own.
Seat on a private jet type of thing.
Yeah, like you could rent 25 hours of your own.
And they think they sold that to Warren Buffett's company, didn't they?
NetJets. And what's beautiful about the whole pitch, I'll let it go till we get to the freedom question because it actually fits perfectly into that.
One of my favorite chapters of Time Collapse.
Yeah,
100%. My favorite, yeah.
It's one of the best, the freedom question. We'll get to it. But anyhow, so he was, I think, to train for like a 100-mile race that he was doing, he would just go up and down this hill, up and down this hill. And I don't know where the idea came from. I think it's third year, fourth year, and everything that him and his wife do now is for charity. And so my wife and I, Nola, my wife and I went out there to do it. And what you just can't see on video, if everyone goes and checks out hellonthehill.com, you can't see on videos how actually brutal the pitch is. It's very steep.
You can't tell. I don't think you could tell. I watch your Facebook video, and you see people going around and around, but I don't – yeah, you can't tell.
So it wasn't until like the 15th lap that I knew I was like in trouble.
And how many – what is –
100 laps. 100. It's 100 up and down. And
which one? It was the 13th?
I'll be totally honest with everybody. I thought I was going to gut it out till – no, I was going to push the pace till I get to 50, 5-0, and then I was just going to gut out the next 50, like just do my Ed O'Keefe style going inside, enjoying that pain place. The challenge that I didn't realize when in training is that it's very hard to replicate the muscles and the angle you use, your feet, your ankles, your back. And so my wife and I train, but running up hills. And once you got on Jesse's hill, you realize quickly that if you're not capable of running up it, you can run up it maybe once, but then the way guys did it quickly is they ran down and then they paced very fast up.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was rough, bro. I mean,
so
I
talk about the end. So this was emotional for you.
Yeah. Yeah, very emotional for me. I mean, I was doing it for charity. I was doing it for my buddy Jeff Usner's charity, where they do it for orphans and whose parents were martyred. It's in I don't know what country it's in. I should know that off the top of my head. And I will personally, when I go into like some people might call a pain cave or whatever, to me it's a very spiritual thing. Yeah. I feel that I've probably had more spiritual moments going to very dark places from a pain perspective of pushing myself to that. And I just think it was 3 hours of grinding up and down, and the heat got to me a little bit. My wife thought I was a little delirious the last 15 laps. And
probably because you were.
Probably was a little bit, but I was okay. I mean, I wasn't delirious. I wasn't hilarious, but it's emotional, man. When you tap in, you know, isn't this one of the most cleansing experiences to tap into parts of your neurology and your spirit and your gut that I think is really getting embraced by our society today, and it's a really beautiful thing. The amount of people that like the fact that Spartan races, Tough Mudders, CrossFit, endurance competitions are things that people get to do. It's not about the race. It's about who you become in the process of the race.
Right.
And also the other thing I would say that's very, very cool is that you have, when you do that, those types of things, you create like a brotherhood and a sisterhood and a family by crying together.
The bonding.
Metaphorically. Yeah. bleeding together. Like my guys from Kokoro Camp, I mean, there's a relationship there because we were there at 3 a.m., 40 some hours in.
Yeah. It's sort of like time collapsing a brotherhood in a sense.
Well, it's zero question is. I mean, it's suffering. You know, like when you suffer together, there's something powerful about that.
Yeah. What does your pain place look like? You know, gutting it out.
So,
because people, you know, I love your perspective on these things because whether it's business or health or whatever it is, it helps get through those tough points or moments.
Yeah. So the way I do this is I have a, and I got to thank Mark Divine for some of it. So I have like this place where I can go that behind me. Or to my right is a line. This is kind of messed up, just so everyone knows this. I realize that.
Well, this is the thing. With time collapsing in general, it's sort of, I picture it merging the soft stuff and the hard tactical business stuff.
Yeah, zero question. Zero. Well, hard life stuff, like some tactical whatever. So I coach volleyball. When we work with my daughter's team and we coach volleyball, you have to have technique and you have to have strategies and tactics, but you also have to have breath work, mental positivity, and like what's not seen.
Yeah.
So in my little pain cave or whatever you want to call it, I don't even really call it. I mean, I guess it's where you go. I have a lion to my right. I have a wolf behind me. I have a gorilla that's there. And it's kind of a foresty place where like there's almost like it's like fall where there's leaves on the ground. Mm-hmm. And then I have a cheetah. When I have to run or do anything that would require the heart rate spiking.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens, Jeremy, is my goal of using these animals is so that when I need them to take over my body, they show up and do that.
Yeah.
And then I then pick people when I got to do different tasks that are very, very hard. So one of my coaches is Chris Smith, former Navy SEAL. And he actually works with our Time Collapsing Academy, our Platinum Mastermind. You've met Chris, right?
Yep.
African American dude. He's out at Trident CrossFit. And he was one of my Kokoro coaches, and I've gotten to know him very well. One of the evolutions we did in Kokoro was it was late at night, 40 some hours in, it's cold, it's whatever. But his evolution was the whole model was 100%, 100% of the time. Yeah, 100%.
I was going to say one thing, you know, with the Kokoro, I remember like, oh, this seems amazing. I want to do this. And then I think I heard a quote from someone who's like, who does multiple Ironman saying it's the hardest thing they've ever done in their life. And I was like, oh, maybe I shouldn't do Kokoro.
Yeah.
Just to give people a perspective on what it is a little bit. So
I'll do that. Let me just finish this.
Go ahead.
So Kokoro Camp was created by Mark Divine, Navy SEAL Mark Divine, Commander Navy SEAL Mark Divine. Out in Encinitas, California, phenomenal man, phenomenal cadre of instructors, and it's designed to be a mini Hell Week. It's for civilians, and it wasn't always designed that way. It's actually a training program he designed for guys prepping to go into the special operations.
Right.
So, Navy SEAL guys prepping to become Navy SEAL candidates. And there was a few in our class. And it wasn't until I think one day, if I know the story correctly, that he saw a man in his class who had gray hair, and he's like, "What are you doing here?" And the guy said, "I want to see if I have what it takes," or something to that effect.
Right.
I stumbled across it because if you look on YouTube, you type in Kokoro Camp or Kokoro and CrossFit athletes, there was like one of the first ones that made it popular was there's a lot of pro level CrossFit athletes in the class. It scared the crap out of me, man.
Yeah. So 100%, 100, or what were you going to say with Chris Hill?
Yeah. I'll get that.
Okay, go ahead.
And so Mark Divine created this. And so there's a lot of, like, you could look on, I mean, people get seriously injured during it. Unfortunately, a candidate died this year.
Oh, my God.
He had an aneurysm. And so it's not a joke. It's
not a joke at all. Yeah.
Like, it's in that actually is what makes it a beautiful thing to be in it. You know, they say, I mean, I don't know. It's a very hard thing to like, you know, like David Goggins, who I had on my show recently, posted a video of, was it a video? No, it was on his Facebook feed where he talked about, his writing's actually really, really good, Goggins. And he talks about a guy who was in his class, who was one of the like team leaders or somebody who was just super strong all the way through Hell Week. And then at like day 3.5, 4, Goggins noticed he was bleeding from his mouth. And everybody by that time had some bang up or whatever. And what Goggins said that he didn't know was that the man's body was failing. And that the in the water evolution, the guy died. Okay?
Well.
All right. So now, most civilians, most natural human being is going to feel a bunch of sympathy for that. But when you surround yourself with like a warrior archetype, right?
Yeah.
They've made it up in their frickin' mind that they are either going to go through it or they are going to die doing it.
Right.
Like, it's a very hard thing for most people to understand. And so one of the coolest things about Kokoro Camp is the day before you go in, because you go in at 8 a.m., you check in at 7 a.m., 8 a.m., from that point on, for the next 51 hours, no one has contact with you. Your parents, your spouse, all that stuff. And so there's that feeling of like you're about to go into the abyss, and there's no turning back, and there's no one there to rescue you. They're not there to kill you. They're there to support you and coach you through it, and make sure you. And they have medical staff on stuff. But that's one of those cool things where you got the only solution you have is to go internal and see what you're made of. Right. And that's where people find a part of themselves that they've never met before.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's the beauty of that. And you can do that in more ways. You don't have to go do Kokoro. You could do some crazy ass evolution like Hell on the Hill, or set a timer and every minute for 90 minutes do 3 pull-ups. Because where it gets cool is that you're going to do 3 pull-ups in 10 seconds. First time. And then you got to think. You're by yourself. You're thinking for 50 seconds. And then you go to the next time. And then by minute 30, it's taking you 45 seconds to get the 3 pull-ups in. And so it's just this space and time where you got to – like people talk about meditation. Well, do that kind of meditation. And you're going to find a part of yourself that now other things become easier, you know.
Right.
And so going back to Chris Smith, so I'll chain it back to this.
Yeah.
So in my secret little space that now I've got – through that experience, I had this like secret garden, you know, before I went to Kokoro, and then since I've did Kokoro and I met some other badass warriors, right?
Yeah.
I've added them to the garden. Like, so Chris Smith, when I need him, I'll hear his voice behind me going, "All right, O'Keefe, 100% of the time," and he's got a different edge to him, and his edge then gets to go inside my body, and I can do that. There was a couple instructors that were really good runners who, in some of the evolutions, I paced myself off their heels.
And you so, just visualize them running.
Just visualize it. It's
gotcha.
Just all made up, man.
Gotcha.
It's all flipping made up.
So it's not always them saying something. It's you visualizing them doing something, too.
Like, yeah. So I'll put Navy SEAL Mark James, like, 6 feet ahead of me when I need to run, have a good pace, because he just, like, is like a gazelle.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's other stuff I did for cold training and stuff prior to that that was cool, and we could talk more about that. Like, I imagined that there was a campfire up on the edge of the Pacific Ocean that I could go when I was doing – and I didn't really need it much when we were in the water.
So for almost for each instance, you were anticipating where you would need to go in yourself.
Yeah, I just did – for training was almost harder than Kokoro because you're by yourself. You have a lot of unknowns. I had some really cool experiences that were more spiritual that involved my pain cave, and maybe we share this later on. But actually,
go for it.
so one of the things that this is kind of hard to like for people that don't. I think everyone can relate to some level. A lot of people know the CrossFit workout called Murph, which is after Michael Murphy, who was, I think, I don't know what his title was, but he was the lead of the Navy SEAL team that had Marcus Luttrell. And could you open your browsers? Or actually, it doesn't matter. I want to give.
What do you want me to look up?
Operation Red Wing, the team. Because I don't want to just say Marcus Luttrell. There it is, Navy SEALs. I want to give full credit to the whole crew.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So it was Matthew Axelman, which they called Axe, Danny Dietz, Marcus Luttrell, and then Lieutenant Michael Murphy. So Murph, the workout, for the people who don't realize, is one-mile run, 20-pound or 25-pound vest on. Now, I was training for Kokoro, so we have rucksacks. So my rucksack was either 25, 30 pounds, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's a one-mile run. I'm trying to think. I don't know. 100 pull-ups, 200 push-ups, 300 body squats.
Wow.
One-mile run, right? So you could do this unbroken. You could do it in, like, stages of one-mile run, and then you could do, like, 5 pull-ups, 10 push-ups, 15 body squats. That's the most common route. I've liked doing 3-6-9 is actually really good too. You just get really dizzy getting up and down. But the quote unquote official Murph workout, if you're doing it, is doing it straight through. So where you do the mile run, then you do a 100 pull-ups with the rucksack on.
Wow.
200 and then 300, right? And then so I'm in full gear prepping for Kokoro, and let me just say, there's freaking athletes that are way better than me at this. So there were some guys I met there that were just so impressive. So this is not at all about my physical capabilities. One of the goals they said, though, is that you should be able to do Murph under an hour. Now, if I break it up, I was able to do it easy in 45 minutes. And then actually after Kokoro, I did it under 40 minutes. So, so for me, that was, but 1 hour straight through, I think my initial baseline time was like 105, 106. And then I had training for about 4 weeks. And by the way, I went to Kokoro about 7 weeks after deciding to go.
Wow. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, because I was planning on going, no, maybe like 8 weeks. I was planning on doing it in February.
It's not a lot of time.
Not a lot of time, and it's I was planning on doing it in February, and after I started training for like 2 weeks, my wife was about to kill me, because as any guys, I mean, I was walking around my house with a rucksack on, boots, changing diapers.
You were just putting kids in the rucksack, like carrying them.
I'd be like, can I go for a walk? And she's like, why didn't you go for a walk? I'm like, because I got to get my mileage, I got to get space. And so I'd take the babies, go for a walk, I have twins. And so Murph, this was kind of like I was about to start tapering, but I had to hit some benchmark mental key components. Like, this is what you don't understand. This is like the difference between being around super high level guys. Is they look at life. There's a lot of black and white. Meaning, I either do X or I die, or I either do this or I fail. Like, there's, you know, at that highest level of competition, The switch has to be very, very, very focused. You can't be like, well, if I sort of don't hit this goal, it's okay. Like, so I had certain criteria in my head. Mm-hmm. One of them was running, you know, an 8-minute mile for 13 miles or whatever. And I didn't hit that, by the way. I was able to do it for 6 miles, and then I started tapering off. And there were certain criteria SEAL Fit gave us. And one of them was, it was very important for me to be able to kick ass on this Murph walk. Like Jeremy, I was psychotic at this point. So I'm going through it, and I started realizing that I was getting close to 50 minutes in. I was like around 48 minutes, and I had like 50 more body squats to go. So I had to bang these out. And you didn't, usually before you run a mile, you don't want to be over suffering before you even get on the road to run the next mile. Because every time I've done Murph in the past, that last mile always sucks. You always feel like you don't want to do it at all.
Right.
And now I had a time limit. And so I think I left the CrossFit gym to run the mile right around 50 minutes, 5-0. And I know in the past though, when I've done the last mile, it usually takes around 10 minutes. So I had a, and I was, so I was fucking hurting, you know, I was running. I got to the halfway point and I had already been in my pain cave. And I was pushing myself, but I, there was a space that there were voices in my head that wanted to tell me that I wasn't good enough to do this.
Interesting.
And yet here I it was like, it's, oh yeah, you know, maybe this isn't for you. Maybe you aren't ready. Maybe you can't do this. Da, da, and I was like, what the fuck? And I had, I don't know what the crazy thing is, but okay. So story for everybody is that I had a brother that died a year before I was, a year and a half before I was born.
Wow.
My brother, Michael, passed away at the age of 15 or 16. Right.
Wow. Sorry to hear that. Jeez.
Well, you know, and yeah, thanks. But here's the, here was the most amazing fucking thing ever. Sorry for the swears. I know you're right. I like, you know,
rock it. No.
Edit it before what? You send it to your
minister. No, I don't edit it at all.
Yeah. Is I was just started praying, like, give me what I, give God, give me what I, like, I need this. Like, and I felt my brother come over my body.
Hmm.
And wow. It was, I mean, I can get emotional thinking about it. And it just like, it was like the coolest thing ever because like the lion was up, the wolf was in me, everything was happening. And it was like that last four blocks or that last half mile, I came running in. I made it by 2.5 minutes, my time. And there's nobody in the gym. It's me by myself.
Right.
Fall to my knees and start crying like I haven't cried in so long.
Yeah.
And so nothing at Kokoro replicated that.
Wow.
You know, like that.
It was all, I mean, in the training.
Some teary eyes near the end there, but that training. I mean, what a beautiful place.
And no, so now, glory. Yeah.
Once you go there and you create that experience, no one can take that away from you. You always have that. You can always tap into that, right? And so that's why I like going and being around people that are doing cooler, tougher, crazier things than me, because it allows me to tap into that warrior part of us, which I personally believe that all of us have it. Even the women, the men, the whatever. I'm seeing more men and women do amazing things. It's just a great thing. And, you know, so I don't know where we went, but that's...
I know exactly where we went.
That's my long answer.
No, you know, what's interesting, Ed, is after you do that, now what, right? So what do you do now to bring the warrior back?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So, like, Hell on the Hill was a great outlet because it gave me... It gave us, my wife and I, something
to look at. And Nola did it too.
She did Hell on the Hill as well, yeah. Yeah, she did as well. You know, and everybody, like, we're raising 7 kids, you know, all under the age of 12. So we got...
That's a pain place you got to go to every day.
You know, I'll tell you, my little chuckle, I always mess around with, like I've said this to Mark Devine, Goggins, and other, like, mental toughness guys. I'm like, just come over to my house between the hours of 4 p.m. and 11 p.m. and see how you make it, you know? See how much mental toughness you got there, you know?
That'd be great.
Yeah, and...
Instead of living with a seal, it's like living with Ed and Nola and 7 kids.
Oh my gosh, bro. Oh my gosh. I don't know what someone would do. But so like that's something that's a daily grind. Like but we love it. Like we love the big family. We love the kids. We love it. And so that is what we do, right? So then to answer your question of like what's next. So Jesse's coming out with a new company that like right now I'm doing the 2017 challenge with Jesse's group where you got to do, you know, 2017 reps of burpees, push-ups, dips, sit-ups, and body squats in January.
Yeah.
And so I'll do that with CrossFit. You know, that's kind of how I maintain. I kind of slacked over the holidays. And then one thing that I've talked – so he's going to do some cool stuff that I'd love to be a part of. I've talked to my wife about, you know, looking at Tough Mudders and so I'd like to get on my calendar the 24-hour Tough Mudder Challenge or some of the midnight challenge. I think everybody should do something where they start at like 10 p.m. and they go all the way to 10 a.m. There's something really magical about being up at 4 a.m. and putting out, like, and you haven't slept yet for 24 hours.
Right.
And you experience a different space of your what's possible.
Right.
So I'm trying to figure that out, man, to be honest with you. There's some cool things going on in our businesses that I want to get stabilized.
So I want to circle back for a second. So how you got into No Foods and it Hell on the Hill, was that the part where it started?
I can tell you exactly where we're at. So I was on Jesse's back porch. I'm sitting there next to Jens Pulver, who's a UFC world champion, and some of the other guys, my wife, some other great people. And Jesse comes out and handing everybody like these muffins. And I just watched it. Everybody just devoured the muffins. And then I heard Jesse say, oh, this new little project we got going on. Well, one success trick I will share with everybody is listen to when people say they're doing stuff, just listen and observe. And then, so what I did, I made a commitment to when I came home from Hell on the Hill. I said, look, I'm just gonna do whatever it takes to help these guys out, like anything. And I knew the health business. I knew how to sell direct to consumer online.
Yeah.
That's my world. I can freaking sell 100% stuff online.
Yeah.
And I have a lot of relationships, you know. We have clients right now that are doing, you know, $30,000, $40,000, $100,000 in sales every day in online marketing, direct to consumer. So if we added No Foods or any of our packages to the back of their sales system, it would make everyone's life better. But what would really grab my attention, Jeremy, is when I came home and I started buying. I bought like 10 people who are authorities in health, fitness, and wellness. Like they're way beyond they're at the next level. Ben Greenfield, Mark Devine, Tom Dillard, Drew Cannoli. I sent one to Rick Steele, who's he's just a badass in a lot of ways. And then a few other people. All of them, when they looked at all the ingredients, tasted it, were like, wow, I've been telling my clients they can't have bread. Now they can have bread.
Mm.
Muffins again. They can have burger buns. They can have all these things because No Foods reinvents and reimagines like what breads are, because it's not made of starch and flour and all these whites and stuff that spike the insulin levels. You know, I mean, it's really crazy. So when I did that, so what happened was, long story short, was how I got to invest in it was I started doing all this help. I got like 10 to 15 testimonials for them. I did I had an 80-page research report based on it. I still haven't even shared it all yet because it's just timing. I just got on the phone with the CEO and he's like, well, we're closing up the friends and family round. And I said, oh, really? What does that mean? Oh, can I get in? And then I went to my wife and said, let's double down here. So we doubled down on this, you know? Yeah.
And go ahead.
Yeah. Here's one thing I realized too, Jeremy, people talk about mastermind groups, which I have one. You're part of them. You come to ours.
They're amazing, yeah.
And I know you're in Brian Kurtz's, and then Joe Polish, all in our circle. All of these guys do phenomenal jobs. There's also another form of masterminding when you align your interests with other highly successful people by being an investor. That gives you access and opportunity that I never really realized was there. And when I say opportunity, I don't mean opportunity to take, but opportunity to contribute and be a part of something that's much, much, much greater than what I would be doing on my own.
And
that is probably the biggest revelation this past year to share with everybody.
Yeah.
That alone. So if I had, I think one of the new habits in my life are going to be is to look for these big, disruptive, opportunities where I can help and contribute and just and be a part of it. Yeah.
Something you could stand behind, something is a bigger vision and attracts good people.
Attracts phenomenal people.
Yeah.
Totally with you, bro. Yep.
So what you've learned from Jesse, being a friend of Jesse Itzler, you were going to talk a little bit about that.
You asked me, you were asking me like what's new, and I was saying, okay, well, the foods, and, you know, so Jesse Itzler is somebody that if anyone has a chance to see him speak or get to meet him, you should take up that opportunity. You know, I think by being around him and his wife, and I've been with Sarah briefly a few times, meeting their kids, being around the people that they surround themselves with, they're doing it the right way. They're just fucking great people. I mean, just flat out. And so my exact comment to my wife was when we were at their house, because we didn't know them. Like I had him on my podcast. I was helping him. I think you were helping him get him on some podcasts. And again, I just liked them. And I was like, I'm going to help this guy any way I can. Not really knowing how. But everybody says, here's one thing I want to tell everybody. Here's another big tip. If I say, hey, Jeremy, what can I help you with today? You may have something that I can specifically help you with. But most people, especially really, really successful people, are going to be like, oh, thanks, man. Yeah, I'm good right now. They're all going to say that. So instead of asking that question, listen to what they're working on and what they're doing, right, and then just go work for free. Because positive stuff, like I want people around. You do this very well, Jeremy. I mean, I think one of your best gifts is you're just ridiculously selfless at every level.
Thank you.
And people like having you around because of that. Because I think, so I don't want to go off on a tangent on takers, but most people are. They're always like looking for what's in it for them. So I just think if people have an opportunity, but one thing I said to my wife was, I go, you know, he's a lot like me. And what I meant by that was, I watch how he treated people around him, and as busy as he is, he always is making sure people around him are taken care of and good. And I don't mean like taken care of like, oh, but like just simple things like, hey, you guys good? You guys need water or anything? Simple things like that.
Right.
And they made us feel very at home. Kish is, you know, so the only other thing that I would say by being around him is that he thinks very big, and you know, at our Time Classic Mega Conference, he said on stage that you know, his superpower is he just does it. And then he also had said one other thing, I guess I can share, because I'm a modeler, right? So I listen to these patterns.
Yes.
Is that he's willing to do almost anything without worrying about what it might make, like the embarrassment or how stupid you might look or you may fail. And just, you know, if everybody just took that phrase and put it in their head like a microchip and just lived that model of the world, like what if I just lived a week thinking like I don't really care at all about failure at all. I'm just going to freaking try stuff.
Right.
Then when you start asking bigger questions, like the freedom question, when you get to that, you all of a sudden start being like, fuck it, you know, let's just go do it. And yeah, I might make a fool out of myself, but it's better than me sitting in my fucking house pretending like someday I will be successful, right, or maybe I will go do that. And I would say the other thing is that life becomes a much bigger adventure when you're willing to try stuff, you know.
Talk about that for a second. So one of my favorite chapters in Time Collapsing, I have it for all you, it's behind you. I have it actually right here. I don't know if you can see it. Is the freedom chapter and the freedom question. So I wanted to have you talk about that. How did you come and realize the freedom question?
So to give everybody like a little bit of background, when I was, you know, 23 to 27, I was pretty much broke. It wasn't until like 26, 27 that I started making money. But I was trying to figure out entrepreneurship, right? And one of the things that I realized was that, you know, when I studied Tony Robbins and stuff like that, that he learned neuro-linguistic programming. So I'm like, all right, cool. Well, I'm going to go learn neuro-linguistic programming because I'm going to be the next Tony
Early
Robbins.
On, you wanted to be a motivational speaker.
I mean, I was, you know, I how successful I was at it, I don't know. But the secret was, one of the things I did very well between 23 and 27, and what's beautiful about being broke when you're younger or even older is, younger, I had time to go do all these seminars. And something I thought mentally was that if I became world class at being a neuro-linguistic programmer and hypnosis, Ericksonian hypnosis, money would follow. Well, that wasn't totally true, but those skill sets I developed supported me forever. So if you read the book Time Collapsing, you'll notice that so much of what I built inside there is based on the tools I used in neuro-linguistic programming. It's not a book about neuro-linguistic programming, just to be very clear. So neuro-linguistic programming means, like, part of it means when I hear people's language patterns, if I can replicate their language patterns, I could then understand, I could almost replicate what they're producing in their head and usually emotional states and behavior. I just simplified it. But one of the things I noticed when I was studying a lot of these time collapsers, people that I think have done extraordinary things in ridiculously short times, from high performance athletes all the way to, you know, billionaire entrepreneurs, is they asked a question like, wouldn't it be cool if we could do blank, or wouldn't it be great, or wouldn't it be awesome? Yeah. And so the freedom question is that most people are stuck in, like, limitation. So one way to quickly shift the energy from being of limitation to being of one of momentum and opportunistic thinking and power and momentum, and to actually future pace yourself past, because there's three exercises in that chapter that walk you through that, but walk you past your limitations and then get your vision out of it. Because a lot of times people say to me, they'll be like, I don't really know how to set my goals. And you start with the freedom question, because it'll shatter a lot of your limitations, right?
Yeah.
And so when I listened to, like, Jesse's thing when he was with Marquis Jets, he said, like, wouldn't it be cool if his first time being on a private jet, if we could do this all the time? Or wouldn't it be, I don't know the exact language.
You studied that, yeah.
His wife, Sarah Blakely, if you listen to her language pattern, was Spanx. What she really said was, wouldn't it be great if we had a pantyhose that didn't run up your leg and I didn't have to, like, wear all the way down to my toes? Something like that, you know.
Right.
Like, but you didn't go up your ass, you know. She didn't use that languaging, but I'm and then if you look at, like, Uber, wouldn't it be great if we didn't have to deal with these stupid taxis and blah, blah, blah. And
big,
like,
disruptions come from that freedom question.
Yeah. So the freedom question, like, wouldn't it be great if we were able to make a bread that didn't have flour, preservatives, and spike the insulin? You know, there's no one doing that. Like Steve Hanley, the CEO at No Foods, that's what he was asking. And so what I started realizing was, I mean, I think Elon Musk, now, and I haven't done much studying with Elon stuff, but, like, look at all the inventions that he's creating. He's got to be asking, like, it'd be so cool to sit and listen to him, like, you know, like, wouldn't it be cool if we were able to put solar panels on every single house in America and blank, you know?
Yeah. And so, what's cool about that is it allows you to pass, you know, get past your limitations. And, you know, what's interesting, Adam, with doing the research, you had this modeling project. This is fascinating to me. You had this modeling project where you wanted to kind of learn the world views of people.
Yeah.
And one thing you did was you took all Will Smith's interviews.
Yeah, yeah.
And you transcribed it.
How'd you know?
I do my research. And you transcribed it.
Yeah.
So what did you find? And I'm curious what you found. I'm curious who else you did this with.
I still got to create a video on him. I did it with Tyler Perry. I did it with Oprah. I did it with it's kind of a project I started, like, 2 years ago, and I just kind of dropped
it. Pretty amazing.
So tell your listeners, if they want me to do it, to, like, ping me on
Facebook. I'm fascinated by it. What did you find with Will Smith? And I'm curious what you find with some of the other ones, too.
Yeah, so Will Smith, I mean, Will Smith's a phenomenal person to listen to. So if you want to do a modeling project and take his language patterns and stick them inside your own neurology.
Yeah.
So imagine, like, the Matrix, you know, and they shove the thing in the back of the guy's head and it's like, oh man, he can go into that. Well, what if we could do that as human beings?
Mm-hmm.
Like, what if we could just say, okay, Jeremy has this belief system, because really we're making it all up as we go.
Yeah.
And the frame that we choose is the frame that we use, right? I've never said that before, but that sounds pretty cool.
It's a tweetable.
It's, yeah, man, hey, whatever. Yeah. But so with Will Smith, there's a couple things, you know. So a phrase that he uses when he was talking about when he was I haven't looked at this in a while, so you're catching
go,
me off.
No, but go ahead. I just
when he did the movie Happiness, what is it called?
Pursuit of Happiness, yeah.
Is he said the quote, and I see it right now in my mind, it was he goes, you know, what Chris and I had in common was that we both came from spiritual households, that what we thought and believed were real in the universe. And that, you know, I don't want to put these words in his mouth, but I'll say this, and that, you know, if we can say it, that the world will go out and create it, and it'll happen.
Mm-hmm.
Like reality, it's substance. And then he talks about Paulo Coelho and the alchemist. This is shit that, like, Will Smith talks about, right? So what I wanted to say there was, instead of just, like, being like, okay, cool, that's what Will Smith is because he's this, mega superstar, that's his deal. No, I want to say, what if I was able to take Will's thought process and say, okay, so this week I'm going to live, then I'm going to believe Will's stuff is real, which is every thought I have is real, and it's going out, and it's going to magnetize and pull that in there. Everyone listening is going like, well, that's law of attraction. Yeah, but my question to you is, do you believe it at the same level Will Smith does, right? The other thing that Will – okay, go ahead, and I have one more thing for Will Smith.
No. I was just going to say, and what you also talk about is you talk about taking action on that. I mean, that creates action.
Well, a frame that you use in NLP is called act as if. Okay. A lot of people have heard that.
Yeah.
But if you act as if something's real, you see doorways that didn't exist prior to
right,
that.
Right. So, yeah. Go on. Yeah, you want to say something else about Will Smith?
I'm just pulling up it. It's been 2 years since I've been in this, right? So he had a couple things, right? So then I took his like value systems and his identity, and I said, I'll read a couple of them for you.
Yeah,
guys.
Go ahead.
So his frames based on, so what I started doing was taking all his interviews and I started mapping out a couple things. Like how does he see himself? So his identity level, then his value structure, then his belief systems. And then what is he, okay, you guys will like this, right? What is driving Will? And then what is he moving away from? Hmm. So he talks about, okay, this is kind of interesting stuff. I like this. So you get me going on the shit that I like talking about, buddy. All right. So let me just move my document over so I can read off it.
Yeah.
He says, I'm the hardest worker. I'm willing to die on a treadmill. He talks about like the difference between him and the reason why he's successful as an actor and nobody else is because he's willing to die on a treadmill. Mm-hmm. Literal language pattern, right? I can accomplish anything I want, especially if I see the path and plan. So criteria on a strategy for Will is he's not willing to die on a treadmill until he sees a path and plan. Criteria. So when you're modeling somebody, do you have that criteria, right? He's a studier of people. Natural desire to study people. I like to do what's called common math. Like, oh, he talks about like when he would see Chris Rock, right? And he would hear him say something and then people would laugh. He would love to study like, well, what made that funny? And he would dissect what made that funny. And yeah, I'll tell you one thing to back up one step. Because there was another guy, who was I thinking of recently, who I really, really – oh. Jamie Foxx was on the Tim Ferriss show. And when you listen to Jamie Foxx, he's a professional modeler, right? Like he knew how to – like the, and so are like some of the best artists and celebrities and actors and people. They're modelers, you know? And one other thing that Will said – I don't want to go too deep into this, but like he sees himself as an expert generalist. I can do everything well. But he doesn't pigeonhole himself, which is why he's been able to have this vast range of things. And if you think about, I'm an expert generalist, and you apply that to anything, like I'm seeing in business right now, the guy who is a generalist but is damn good at getting good enough at a high performance level at a lot of things is probably your best CEOs nowadays. The specialist expert gets overpassed very, very rapidly.
Anyone stick out to you that you model or follow from the expert generalist in business?
Well, I mean, I think like if you, Right now, who would stick out to me? No, I don't know if I would say anybody, because I haven't studied anyone long enough. But here's the thing I would say. What I've noticed now by spending more time with companies that are looking to disrupt and go, like, you know, to become billion-dollar companies, the people involved have to understand enough about the financial stuff, like with capital, financial metrics, raising capital, the throughput of cash flow. They have to understand enough about operations, and they have to understand enough about marketing and sales so that they're able to pitch this. So, you know, that's a very holistic thing.
Yeah.
And I learned most of my stuff in the trenches. So what I'm really, really good at was definitely learning through trial and error. But, I learn a lot. I'm learning stuff every day. So, I don't know. I just want to say no right now. But I think our good friend Vinny Fisher is, like, he's definitely an expert generalist. Like, he knows some stuff very, very well. But he's also very smart in the marketing and sales department. And but I want to think, like, I think a guy like Jeff Weiner from LinkedIn.
Who else sticks out to you?
Like, if you're really trying to be a leader of your culture and your environment,
yeah.
And for anyone who's listening who wants to be like a leader CEO, he'd be somebody I would go listen to like six or seven of his interviews.
Mm-hmm. Who else did you do this with? The modeling and worldview, like Will Smith.
Oprah. I took some Oprah stuff and did that. Mm-hmm. Hugh Jackman, I'm a big fan of. So I think I transcribed some of his things. Art of Modeling Greatness. Yeah, I mean, that's all I'm going to share now. Yeah.
I thought that was fascinating that you did that.
Yeah, that's definitely a pet project that I think would be fun to do. The other side I've thought of doing is just taking time collapsing and 2.0 it is putting some of these modeling cases inside of it.
Yeah, it's like language patterns of the highly successful, whatever it is.
Yeah. And I think once your listeners or people study language, this sounds kind of like bad, like, oh, I'm going to go study Spanish. No, just listen differently. And then when you hear things like so when I were like, what drives Will Smith? Like, and so what he's moving away from is not screwing up, driven from don't mess it up. And he was talking about an example he uses, and I pulled this from multiple places, where he was going to be Muhammad Ali, and he called Denzel. And Denzel Washington goes, oh, man, you better not screw it up.
No pressure.
Yeah. The fact that he shares the story, shares with you that it meant enough emotionally to be a driver inside his, you know, gut.
Yeah.
And so, you know, those are the things that you're like, oh, man, I'm going to, like, that drives him. And then, you know, I love listening to those language patterns.
Yeah, because it's a huge opportunity for him. And we probably have those too. And we may say those things. What I love about the book and what I love about the freedom question is it brings it to the consciousness. So, like, we may do some of these things maybe some of the time. But when you bring it to consciousness, you can actively practice it and do it.
Yeah, well, the freedom question actually opens up how easy things can be. So if you're like, man, wouldn't it be great if we were able to get no foods in every CrossFit gym selling no foods products? Mm-hmm. Or wouldn't it be great if, you know, Inspired Insider was the most listened to podcast on inspiration in America? You start asking different questions.
Right.
You start thinking, okay, how do we make that happen?
Yeah.
Or who do we need to know? And so the strategies come after that. And a lot of times it's just a matter of consciousness and then laying it out and then blocking and tackling to make things happen, you know?
Yeah. I want to hear what your favorite story or chapter is, but I want you to first talk about losing the friction. So
losing the friction is a chapter that I will share with you. That it's, I think, chapter 3, and I didn't know if it should have just been put as like chapter 15. And my editor did a nice job of saying, no, it's got to be chapter 3. Because here's the deal, right? So chapter two is talking about the trap, then chapter three, the trap. And so just to give everyone context, so the trap is that, you know, we're brought in this world, we go to preschool, kindergarten, first, second, third, fourth, you go into high school, 10, 11, 12, you're supposed to go to college, you're supposed to leave college and become, life's supposed to be perfect. But then you realize, you know, most people are unemployable now, you're not going to make the money you're supposed to make. You marry somebody because you feel like you're supposed to get married. You buy a car, you buy a house, and all of a sudden you're 33, you're in debt, you're married to someone you may not like, you don't know, whatever, and you're not even close to being ahead financially that you thought you would be by that age.
Right. We're painting a great picture here.
Great picture.
You're going to have seven kids living with you in about...
So I was
8 years? 9 years?
Quite frankly, I mean, I'll just share with everybody. At 33, I was and am living the dream. I had four kids under the age of four and good business, you know, whatever. But just like anybody, we go through challenges and whatever. It's part of marriage, part of business, part of life. That's part of the beauty, right? So, you know, I talk to my parents a lot about how, you know, they've been married. They're 85. They've been married 50-something years.
Amazing.
And so...
Forget you. I'm interviewing now.
I'm gonna have my mom on soon. Yeah, I'm on our show, and then she doesn't want any part of it. She's like, I don't want to be on that Facebook TV. Yeah. So that's the trap. And then so the other side is that when the reason I put losing the friction is because what I found is that most high performers don't need more stuff to do. They need more distinctions and stuff taking away.
100%.
So if I'm going to go work with a high-level person, my job, if I was a performance coach, I don't feel like I am one one-on-one. We work with our clients. We have some stuff we do, the books, is to remove blockages and remove mental filters that are holding them back, remove relationships that are holding them back. You know, I mean, one simple thing is, hey, write down the 10 people you spend the most amount of time with. Write the letter N or T next to their names. N is nurturing. T is toxic. How do you end the relationships or quit spending time with the people that have a T next to their name? Guess what? You're going to have more energy. Your time's going to be freed up. You're going to have less obligation. You're going to have all these positive things are going to start happening in your life. And so that's losing the friction chapter. And it's a really powerful one. I think I have 12 steps you can go through to identify and move. Like obligation. You know, if you feel like you are obligated, get out of the relationship as quickly as possible. Where am I seeking approval? Why am I in something? Because I'm seeking approval. How do I get out of that? How do I stop that? You know,
You said this at your at the Time Collapsing conference, and that really struck me about removing the friction, because it's things we could do in our business for our customers. What friction are we putting up for our customers that shouldn't be there? And also, what friction are we putting in our own system? So when I heard you say that, it was really big, taking things away, because there's things I do with the podcast or whatever it is. Why am I doing it? I'm just creating friction for myself and getting less done. So I love that.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you a really good example. So podcasting is one of those things that, like, I have no idea where my podcast is going.
If you did, I'd be worried about you.
it's an evolving thing.
100%.
But one guy who I liked what he's doing is Mike Rowe from Dirtiest Jobs. You know Mike Rowe?
I know who he is.
Have you ever listened to his podcast?
No, I never have.
It's freaking awesome, man. It's just him telling a story. It's called This Is How I Heard It, and it's 7 minutes long.
Okay.
And it's just him talking. And I was thinking, you know, wouldn't it be cool if I could create a whole podcast without having to, like, book guests and deal with that and whatever? Like, what if I just did whatever the frick I wanted to talk about?
Yeah.
Like, hey, here's is it true that Trump is it true that Trump was having sex with a you know, in a Russian bathhouse with 20 men? You know, I don't know. You know, like and have like a podcast about that, you know, just why? Because it's funny. You know, do you want to talk about it? You know, I probably wouldn't talk about politics. But, you know, here's the thing that I learned this week. Boom, share it. And that's 7 minutes. I could talk for seven. We've been talking for like, we could have 10 podcasts with just this episode with that model. I think I have a couple more. I have some really good interviews that we've done, but
you could do something easy. Like just take a chapter of your book. You could do 10 of them per chapter or something.
You know what I was thinking of doing, man? Yeah. I was thinking just like literally picking out a paragraph and then read the paragraph and then don't even go into like it. But go like, you know what, where I got this idea, right, and then go off on a totally different right. story that has nothing to do with giving more of the book.
Yeah. Well, you that's know? What we just did. I mean, essentially the freedom question. I was curious. I'm curious from a reader and implementer standpoint where the background came from. So it was interesting to hear the NLP and then you add in the color because really – you know, the book is 10% of the whole story, maybe less than that, of how you came to it. So I find that very fascinating, you know, the NLP stuff, and then that's interesting with the modeling stuff, but it's the freedom question chapter. So
yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. So I love that. But for you, in the book, are there any particular chapters or concepts that get overlooked or your personal favorites?
I would say definitely the chapter 21, When Your Soul Awakens, chapter 20, The Ghost of Your Past Self.
Why? What's When Your Soul Awakens? Why is that overlooked or why is that your favorite?
The Soft Side of Success. Because that's more where I'm at right now. Like, you know, like this was a book I felt I needed to write. Like, this is the book that is in my opinion, literally the tool book for how to be successful and how to block and tackle. And here's the yin and yang of success. And now that I've written it, I think I'm going to go write more stuff that I just want to talk about. Like the ghost of your past self. I started writing a country song called The Ghost of Your Past Self. Swear to God. I was like, you know, I have some friends in the country music business. I'm like, man, I'm going to write.
Was this inspired by your Nashville conference?
No, this was inspired recently where I was just like, you know, I love country music. And I was like, man, like I was thinking about like the man's desire to always have an adventure in life, even as they get older. And it's about a conversation with the woman he's in love with, his wife. And he's saying how we are the ghost of our past selves. And he talks about how, and so in the book, I talk about how the reason why I've always evolved from business to business and why I feel like a chameleon, not a chameleon, an evolving positive virus, you know.
That's the new title of your book, an evolving positive virus.
Yeah, I know. The next book's called Permission.
You were definitely doing the next book?
Yeah, there's a couple books in line. But the Permission, I wrote the outline today and it's like,
that's a great title.
Thank you. So you better not, no one better steal it, but it's, I literally like, it was, boom, there it was today. Wrote it this morning at breakfast. I've had it in my head.
The best books have like a one word title like that you get it all. Yeah, go on.
Yeah, I mean, 21 ways to free yourself and live an inspired life or inspire the world, something like that. And so it's just really about, because like, you know, like, well, what everyone's secretly wanting. This is the big fucking secret, everybody. We're all looking for somebody to give us permission to go become ourselves, just be ourselves. That's all you're asking for. You mean I really love doing podcasts? I really love talking to people. You mean I can get paid freaking talking to people? Well, I don't know, but go for it. You're going to find out, right? Hey, I kind of want to go play music. All right, well, fucking go play music. You know, I want to go, you know, go live in a different climate. Go live in a different climate. I mean, what is the worst thing that's going to happen? You're going to find out you don't like living in a different climate, or you're going to find heaven. One of the two, you know. Like so I think, So I mean, that's I was probably talking about something prior. Oh, so the ghost of your past self, and then when your soul awakens, is about like the next evolution of. It comes from the Carl Jung I think I talk about it a little bit here, like, you know, Carl Jung, idea of, it's right here, buddy. Give me one more second.
Go ahead.
You know, Wayne Dyer has a movie called The Shift. Did you see it?
No, I didn't.
You've heard me recommend this like five times.
I've gotten several books he recommended, so don't get on me too bad. Yeah.
No, it's a movie. No,
I know.
It's on YouTube. It's free.
All right. It's on the list now.
Yeah, just play in the background. I've literally watched this thing probably 30 times.
Really?
Literally.
The Shift.
Like, sometimes I'll just play it right now while I'm working. Mm. And it starts off with like a Carl Jung quote, which just says, "Thoroughly unprepared, we take the step into the afternoon of life. Worse still, we take the step with the false presupposition that our truths and our ideals will serve us hitherto. But we cannot live the afternoon of life according to the program of life's morning. For what was great in the morning, or for what was true in the morning, will be little at For what was great in the morning will be little at evening, and what in the morning was true at evening will have become a lie."
Yeah.
Let me break that down.
I've heard you say that. Yeah, go on.
So I'm 41 right now. So when I look back at being 28, I wish I could have told myself a couple things. But the rules that I operated through in the life that I thought was success, now, like, those were the rules in the morning. Now we're in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. It's like, dude, those were so not – so much of that is not important. And then by the – you know, as I move into this next chapter of life, which I plan on living a long life, God willing and health willing, that doing stuff of meaning and stuff that inspires me and stuff that energizes me and makes a difference is way more important to me than just accumulating or doing things because, you know, so that's some stuff that most people probably don't get that far into the book, you know, so.
But you have to go through that at the time when you're 28, right, to experience where you're at now.
I think there's definitely a part of that, you know.
I want to kind of pick up with the NLP stuff for a second, and because your next thing was dentist profits.
Yes, yeah, so I'm right. Dentist profits.
So why dentists?
Well, So I'm gonna give you the quick version because we just went from all this great, awesome stuff talking about, like, so dentistry.
No, but I think there's some cool things that you're gonna hit on here.
So you know, my first businesses that actually made any money, even though I don't know if it was profitable or not, was called like the Coaching Success System or Ultimate Volleyball Mental Toughness System, which I think if you look on Google, it would show up, you know. I realized that all my mentors that I was buying stuff from, who were saying that they were making 30 grand a month, 50 grand a month, whatever, they were selling to business owners or people that had money. And here I was selling to like coaches who had no money.
Yeah.
And I realized, man, I'm in the wrong business. You know, I wanted to make money. And I think this is like one of the things I wrote down, like in permission, like permission to ask for more. It is okay to say like, hey, look, I want to go make seven figures. I want to experience.
No one has a book called Permission.
Yeah, no one has a book.
Wow.
Let's get it.
That's a great. You better buy the domain now. Who owns the domain Permission?
Oh, let's find out.
Wow. That's it's a phenomenal title.
Yeah, Seth has Permission Marketing. Seth Godin.
Okay. Yeah.
Permission.org. Say, what's up, Seth? Once him and I become friends, we can. The book, Permission.
So you modeled and you saw these people selling B2B at the time.
Yeah. And I was like, you know, hey, they're making money. I'm going to go do that. You know, and so I did a little research, and the end goal was that it's a white collar market. They had money. I knew nothing about dentistry. And we just use modeling, and I license the license sales copy, and I license the product and from different industry and moved it over to this industry. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But how you came up with it, I thought was fascinating. With the yellow,
the yellow pages.
The yellow pages.
So yeah,
because
so,
people can still use that concept in anything.
Yeah.
You know.
So you know, you just—I mean, I think most people fail to do research, to be honest with you. But yeah. Like so, what I always teach is when you get into business, so like, you want to make this as fail-proof as possible. So you want to get as many, many models and criteria met. And one of the big criteria you want to make is, in that business, the goal was to look at every industry, like blue collar, white collar, in the yellow pages. And that this is before really the internet was you couldn't really do research in the internet. And so what was crazy about it was I just went through I had a yellow legal pad of paper and just little tabs and was marked, you know, contractors, one page of a yellow page ads, realtors, 40, chiropractors, you know, 18, dentists, 22. And what that told us was real estate market was very competitive. Chiropractors, there was already somebody in that market who was doing similar stuff to what we were going to be teaching. And dentistry, there was not a competitor similar to what we were doing. It was kind of new marketing at the time, direct response.
Yeah.
And so we entered the dental market.
Mm-hmm. There's a couple things that I find interesting about Dentist Profit. One was the way you came up with it. Two was this the time where you were getting really into learning and writing copy? What point did that happen? Because I think that's a skill set. I consider you, even though you don't consider yourself a copywriter, I consider you one of the top people who writes copy.
Thanks, dude. Yeah.
So who are you studying at the time? I
was a sales copy for my mental toughness business, right? And then, so I had to get up. I mean, it was all about sales copy back then. And it still is in some ways. Now.
It is, 100%.
You know, whether it's video or audio or whatever.
Whether you want to sell your book. I mean, all of it's copy. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, yeah. And quite frankly, that opened up a lot of doors. Because at the age of 27, I looked like a pro on paper.
Who were you learning from at the time?
Jeff Paul, Dan Kennedy, Gary Halbert, John Carlton.
Mm-hmm.
And just handwriting sales letters in the morning, then typing them out, you know, and that was my system. And then, you know, what I didn't really understand back then, Jeremy, was I didn't understand cash flow management like I wish I did. The dental niche, our cost per lead was so much higher than what like the chiropractor was experiencing or what the realtor was experiencing.
Really?
Yeah. And I think that's because in like a chiropractic office, still to today, you can send a direct mail piece to a chiropractor's office and chances are he's going or she's going to open it or it's going to get to them. And in a dental office, there's more gatekeepers, I think.
100%.
Yeah. So well, I think
one, I'm a chiropractor. Two, my dad's a dentist. So I can tell you there's a lot more gatekeepers in the dental office for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Zero question. So I think that's one of the key things as well.
The other thing I found interesting, Ed, was when I was doing the research, two things that did the best in the Dentist Profits, which I wanted you to talk a little about, is two niche coaching clubs.
Yeah, niche coaching clubs. So, this is I think where you know, like, the secret to like, I'll tell you, I was on the phone with a client right before I got on this call.
Yeah.
And he's got a product that's working, and he's telling me about a new product he's going to create to a different market. I was like, dude, stop. You have something that's working. You need to drive it out. and find out what else they want. And what I think most people underestimate is the level of effort that's required to push the boulder uphill,
right,
to get it to start moving downhill.
Right.
And so I had probably gone 2 years into the dental business where I was making money, but I was still like, it was month to month. And it's when I started figuring out, like, I started listening to my clients and they would say something like, you know, kind of like, wouldn't it be great, very much like the freedom question, if you were able to just train our staff for us? And I was like, all right, cool. And then a consultant came around that I really liked. We got along great. So we started a business together. That business was a total smash. And then I started noticing all my most successful clients came from a particular niche, like of dentists, like a specialty.
Like implants or something like that.
They were general dentists who also did implants.
Yeah.
And so I created an entire coaching program just for that niche.
Mm.
And that was a smash hit, you know?
Yeah. I could tell, like, obviously the time collapsing is your passion right now. When I go to the dentist profits, it's like, I don't care about talking about this.
Yeah,
but I think there's a couple key things in there that I think are important that you use now.
That's right. Like, if you look at the chapter in my book called The Ghost of Your Past Self,
yeah,
the guy back then was a ghost. Like, that guy does not exist anymore. He was a trail that I've left behind, you know? And so
concepts live on, though. Like, from your motivational speaking days, the NLP stuff lives on. The copywriting lives on.
Yes.
The niche, like, your mastermind is specifically niche to people who have health businesses.
No, it isn't.
Well, one of them is.
Well, it started off that way.
Yeah.
But then when I started meeting guys that wanted to be in the mastermind, they weren't health guys. Maybe you didn't know this. But then we opened it up. So here's the other thing.
Yeah.
We started realizing that there was a lot of guys who didn't even know that they should have a health division of their business, who were selling, like, say, survival stuff or e-commerce widgets. Like,
right.
And they should be in the health business, but they didn't even know they could.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, they're in the health business, and they're instantly profitable because they added a health department. We have a guy who's like a med spa clinic who now has a health division. And he's like, well, we were just giving like vitamin D shots or whatever they were doing in the, blood transfusions. I'm kind of joking, but now the opportunity for everybody expands. So I get bored, and so like there's people that look in the past and they live in the past, and that's okay. I really am future focused, and there's pros and cons to that. The con is that sometimes you don't drive out what is a big opportunity sitting right in front of you because you're like, yeah, but that's who I was, you know, in the past, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I literally could go back in the dental profession and do exactly what I was doing, update it to this day, create a story around, well, I'm back and I have all this new stuff, and we could very quickly ignite excitement, you know.
Yeah, because, I mean, at that time, at the height, it was $6 or $7 million, and most people would just be 100% happy with that. And then you shifted to marine essentials.
I shifted, but there was also market forces happening that were affecting those businesses, just so everyone knows. I didn't just close down and jump ship. It was right around 2009. So 2008, everything crashed, and dentists were no longer spending money on group coaching clubs like they probably are today. They're probably back doing it. And I knew that I either, A, had to go deeper into their offices and create more of a consulting program, which I did not want to do at all, or create a turnkey online marketing division that we did a lot for them. So one of the things I did is I said to one of my employees at the time, Greg Prestes, I said, look, dude, here's the thing. This is what's going to happen to our business in the next, 3 to 6 months. So what I could do is give you a severance right now. You go start this business. I'll be your number one referral. And I think like he was making more money within 2 months being out of my business, starting his own turnkey like search engine ranking, you know, local search business. And he's still kicking ass today. That's 6 years ago. 100% him though. Like that's all him. I do not want to take any credit for that. It was just the dynamics were shifting. And then that the staff business, I sold that division. So there were things that were happening, and I thought, you know, it's probably a good opportunity to start to transition.
Yeah. So I want to talk about Marine Essentials starting, but I know you like talking about future and current. So I want to start in, you mentioned some rebranding stuff that's going on.
I've had Marine Essentials for like, what, almost 7 years. And at our height, we did around $30 million, a little under $30 million in 1 year. And then made a ton of mistakes on hiring and then infrastructure development from a tech perspective. So that was a few years ago. There's a few things that happened this year that put closure on some of those relationships in a really nice way. You know, I kind of had a discussion with myself, which is like, look, I have a lot of phenomenal assets sitting right here. We're still doing, you know, a few million a year. And the path and plan with social media nowadays to reinvigorate the business and double it and triple it, in my opinion, has never been like potentially easier. I don't want to say it's easy, but I think it's potentially a lot easier than it's ever been. Mm-hmm. And so, so I brought on a couple new team members and we're just going back at it, you know? And so that's kind of on the supplement side, that's where it's at. And it's amazing how, like, you know, once you ride a bicycle, you know how to ride a bike. And so
talk about time collapsing. I mean, when you were starting Marine Essentials, time collapsed. So talk about, like, in the very beginning when you started
When I started, I made a lot of mistakes. I was listening to the wrong people, and I lost like $150,000 out of the gate.
From doing what?
Blew up my merchant account. Well, because, you know, we created a whole product offering around giving a free trial. And at the time, a lot of the courses that were out there teaching guys were like, oh, you can make $30,000, $50,000 a day. And they were doing free trials. What most people don't realize, there's so many things, there's so many traps. There's so many traps when it comes to the free trial market. And what I mean by that is I'll just kind of give everybody like the insect thing.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, there's people buy stolen credit cards online and then will go in. If they're getting paid a $30 commission, they'll go in and sign up for these free trials using a stolen credit card. And by the time anyone knows what is going on, you've already paid out the commission and the bank doesn't realize that it's a fake one. You've paid $30. You're supposed to be getting your second rebill, which would be say $50 or say $69 in 15 days. That never goes through. And so I was just working with the wrong. There's definitely ways to mitigate that, but I was working with the wrong people, who really didn't take care of
the merchant
relationship. No, they. So fraud, it's called fraud traffic. And what happens is it's just so crazy. Your listeners are going to be like, this is just crazy. But they'll send in like, say, they'll go like, say, like now the day now would be like, okay, they go get like two sales on Facebook. They put one fraud sale in. So you don't really catch it because it's only one out of three or one out of five. And then all of a sudden when you lower your risk tolerance or whatever, one day they'll throw 30 or 40 or 50 through and you get 100 sales. And you're like, man, I'm going to be rich. Well, in 15 days, only 35 or 40% of your sales go through, but you paid out commission on 60% more than that. So this happened to me. And then, I mean, I allowed that to happen because I didn't know better. So now I know better. So we stayed in the business. I stayed in the business. I shut down that business. And I stayed into it, and I grinded it out. I hired consultants that I trusted, that I learned from, and man, I mean, the book has a ton of our stories. I have some videos up on our website you know, on just sharing more in depth about the health supplement business. But there's a lot of things that can go wrong. And so one of the things that I do with our consulting and our coaching clubs is and I'm not pitching everybody on this, but it's like one of the things we do is we time collapse their capability of going from zero or even having some success to, you know, it's their success. But my job is to mitigate all their risk by coaching them on my lessons and then introducing them to people who are quote unquote good in the business, you know. So that's what we do, you know. And, you know, I have some guys in the supplement business, some guys in the health information business. We have some clients that are consultants, you know.
I mean, I say the time collapse because even before you...
I have a friend, I mean, Ed Clay runs a hospital down in Mexico. He's in our group, you know.
Yeah.
So kind of interesting, you know.
He's amazing. I say that because before you had that campaign with the initial offer that you lost money, you would create the product and the team and consultant before then, didn't you?
No.
So that was after, for the actual product creation.
The Marine D3 that took off and still does very well today, that was after.
That was after. I gotcha.
Yeah. So there was somebody who was helping me, but I didn't really realize that he was getting a piece of the action from the traffic guys on the side. And so I was like, the guy at the poker table that didn't realize there was a different game going on.
That's so horrible.
Yeah. So when stuff blew up, I was the only one that was left with the bad hand.
I see.
Saw my money.
So the next iteration was the Marine Essentials. And talk about the first campaign, because I find it interesting.
The first campaign was in direct mail. You know, that's what you're referring to.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Direct mail, 60,000 pieces, two different tests. And it pulled pretty well out of the gate. And then,
did you send in the mail?
A magalog, like a 16-page, full color.
Wow,
looks like a catalog.
You went all out on the first mail.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I spent like $30,000 on the copywriter, and then, you know, I mean, we were doing it as a, I really wanted to grow this company to like $100 million company. What I didn't know in hindsight was that I should have had a million. I should have either raised $1 million or just. Known that I needed or get a line of credit for $1 million. So, you know, when you go into that business, the speed of turnover of cash flow and acquiring more customers and having a lot more products to market to your existing customers becomes a much more important element. So
you didn't write the copy for it.
No, I've done most of what's online, and but no, I hired a pro level. So here's the thing. Here's a really good tip. If you're gonna go into a media that, you know, it's the whole, if you have a gun to your head, you got to make this work, or else your kids are gonna die, and and you're going into a new media which is called direct mail, and you're like a pro. But that's like the pro wrestler going into an MMA ring, and he doesn't understand that you can get kicked in the head. And when you take people down, they know how to defend a wrestler, right? So you got to know what arena you're in, which actually there's a whole chapter about know the landscape, the rules, and the lies. Mm-hmm. And so we went and hired, you know, I got a doctor involved. We had a lot, you know, we had a pro level team.
Yeah, 100%. And, anything, another lesson learned from Marine Essentials that'd be important for people? I know, like, there's a couple things that stick out. Interesting stuff with email drops and then what you discover with the offers. But I'm curious for you, what sticks out to you?
Well, I mean, I'll just give one super high level, which is a great tip, is just, you know, offer crazy offers to your existing customers right out the gate about where they could buy a lot more, like a 10-pack bundle, 6-pack bundle, and save, you know, 40%, because here's the deal. They're in a buying mode and they may never come back to your store ever again. So give them more offers of big stuff, and don't inhibit. like we talk about this value ladder thing of like, you know, of going from step one to step two, step three, step four. There's truth to that. Like there's the awareness, but then there's other people like hyper responding buyers like me. If I see something I like, I just freaking let me buy.
You just want to go it, yeah, and get it.
And there's a lot. There's about 20% of your, or maybe even 12%, maybe 1% of your buyers might be that way. But cater to them. Give them more opportunity. And because they may make way more money than 70% of your other guys, and that will give you the revenue to acquire a lot more customers and profitably.
Ed, this has been fantastic. I have one last question. I know you have seven kids to get to. You have three businesses. You have to get to do a Kokoro, full Kokoro workout today.
I got my work. I'm good.
But before I ask it, we can point people towards the edoketheshow.com, timecollapsing.com. Where else should people check out online?
That's cool. That's good. Now, Ed O'Keefe Show. If people like going to seminars, you know, we do our Nashville event. We're planning on doing that again in 2017 and 2018. Like, make that a
highly thing. Recommend it.
We have a health supplement intensive that we're probably going to have come out here shortly. Mm-hmm. Which I'll walk people through for 2 days, everything they need to know. Go check out nofoods.com. Go get some
KNOW.
KNOW foods.com. Get the waffles or go to Amazon Fresh. I mean, get them, get the waffles. You're going to be like, and they have donuts coming out. Oh my God. It's crazy.
So last question.
Yeah. Last question.
Maybe it's two, one, I want to get your fun facts, but the question I was going to ask was, if there's some kind of crazy birth story with seven kids, some crazy family story.
Oh, geez.
But the fun fact, you said you had two fun facts that were sticking out in your head.
My mom would know the birth story. She knows all. I mean, she really knows. She's like, oh, like, I don't know if I was hard coming out or if I was easy coming out.
Not you. I mean, your kids. Like you and your.
Geez. Okay. So you want to know my kids?
Yeah.
Yeah. We had some crazy stuff going on. So like our first two children, like Michael and Grace, both of them were impossible to come into this world. So actually one fun fact is that like my wife might kill me for sharing this, but like
I don't want her killing you.
The last five kids came out cesarean section.
Hmm.
It's four C sections. Just mad at
me. Why would she make mad at you for that?
What's that?
Why would she?
I don't know.
Oh.
Might be like, why are you sharing that? But whatever. I mean, this is what it is. I would say that I'll tell you one more quick thing about Grace. Like, so when Grace was born, she had the cord wrapped around her neck twice. Oh, she came out white as a ghost. Did not cry for like the first, like, I don't think she cried. I think they pulled her out and they immediately rushed her off.
Wow.
And so, you know, my wife and I went down to the NICU, I think it was NICU, and the lady was trying to explain to us like the oxygen, how she was on oxygen, she's intubated, and how she's not really breathing on her own or some shit like that. She did a bad job explaining it.
That's not a good time to do a bad job explaining something, but yeah.
It really was, yeah. It was like, and it was like 2:30 in the morning. And so, she'll be on this probably for a day or so. And then as she gets stronger, she'll be able to breathe on her own, right? And so it wasn't until like, I think like around 7 a.m., maybe a little bit, like, they called our room and they're like, your daughter is off the intubator. You can come see her. So I come and I'm like, hey, Nola, you want me to push you down? And Nola was out, you know, out of it. And she goes, no, just go. So I went down there and man, I'll tell you. So I opened the door and the first baby right there was Grace and she was crying. She had her big eyes crying at me and I just put my arms like over her and I just started bawling. And in that moment, Jeremy, in that moment, my heart was now no longer in my chest. It was taken from me.
Yeah.
And so I was trying to explain it to her the other day. She goes, you mean I broke your heart? And I'm like, no. You stole my heart.
How old is she now?
12.
12, okay.
And so I think,
Yeah,
that was one of a very special moment. And then, after that, it's all easy. No, I'm kidding. They're all, I think the one thing about parenting that I think is always interesting is you never realize how different your kids are. Like, they're just different. Like, you're like, you mean that you both came from the same parents? And you are just two totally different spiritual, like, things out here.
Yeah.
We love it. We have a great time with it. I would say to everybody, you have permission to be kind and patient to yourself as a parent.
Yeah.
Because it's not an easy job. And if you don't have kids and you don't want kids, well, you have permission to be patient with yourself as well.
Ed, phenomenal. Thank you so much. Anyone who has a chance to check out what Ed is doing, his stuff, his conference, his book.
You didn't ask my fact, man.
That was, how can I top a story about you and your daughter, Grace? Okay, I mean,
next time we'll do the fun fact.
If you want to share them, go ahead. I know you have to go.
No, but, no, okay.
Okay, next time. Yeah. But this was phenomenal, Ed. Thank you so much. People should check out No Foods. They should check out the EdO'KeefeShow.com, Time Collapsing. You're a special person. I appreciate you. Thank you. What I got, you can't buy. It resides between my eyes. Walked through the fire, came out better on the other side. See, life's like a beach if you find the sand. And right now, I'm feeling like 100 grand.